Welcome to the Gritty Podcast. I am your host, Brian Call, and I am joined today by my little brother behind the camera, the Gritty Broman. How are you, Brent?
I'm well. Thank you.
Today, we're going to talk a little bit, well, a lot of bit, about quitting and not quitting, about sticking it out, about solo hunting. I get a lot of messages from people each season. People asking, you know, how do you do it? How do you stay out there? How do you do it solo? How do you not quit? You know, how do you make it happen? And, you know, if you think about it, a lot of us think about elk season. Let's just take elk hunting, archery elk season. It, in general, it's a pretty easy tag to get across Western states. Everybody can do it. Everybody sort of dreams about it, wants to do it. Mm-hmm. They prepare year round. They try to get fit. They shoot their bows, you know, they hone their skills and they prepare for elk season. And there's only one rutting elk season, September, every year. Okay. And so a lot of us, you know, prepare and think about it and kind of dream about it, watch films about it. Right. And then thousands of us go out into the mountains or in the woods and do our elk hunts. And there's thousands who go out with the intention of a 12-day or 10-day, 7-day hunt, mm-hmm. hunt 3 or 4 days.
Use their whole 2 weeks vacation.
Yeah, and then quit early. And then they go home, and then they're left, you know, kind of in a position of being frustrated by their themselves, you know. I got a text message this season, in fact, from a friend of mine, and I'm going to read his text, and this is going to sort of lay the groundwork for the discussion I want to have. I was going to send him a note individually and just kind of talk or give him a call, but I figured this way, anyone in the same boat as he is can sort of, we can just, you know, have this discussion more openly and address everyone that might be in the mm-hmm. same boat, more efficient. And I think it's a good discussion to have.
I think a good message. I think when Tim Ferriss said, when he set about to write his book series, mm-hmm. he always picked one or two friends that the book series was dedicated to.
Yeah.
And he said, it makes it more powerful and it will resonate with more people that way. If you focus on an individual. So
I'm not going to say his name,
but this is
or her name. But this is
or preferred pronoun.
This is the message I got toward the end of September. It said, "Hey Brian, I just wanted to reach out and let you know that I'm enjoying the land of the spotted eagle. Also, I'm now catching your series on River of Doubt, and I'm hooked. I'm reaching out because I feel like I've failed this year on my second year out as an elk hunter. Not because I failed to fill my tag, but I came home early. I headed to this state the 17th and was in the state until the 19th. I had till the 30th if I wanted and was back home on the East Coast on Thursday the 24th. My reason? Well, going solo again for the second year, I thought I could hang. But being in a new area for the first time, seeing lots of pressure from other hunters, not seeing elk, not knowing where to go to find them except for general elk knowledge, and general loneliness had me make the decision to leave that Tuesday. I've regretted it ever since I got home. I feel like I've wasted a tag and, more importantly, time I will never get back. I'm embarrassed and a little ashamed for myself for all the hard work that I put in. I still got it in my own head and I quit, even after all that preparation. I was listening to the first part of the River of Doubt series, and man, I wish I had started that when I was out there. I guess I'm still learning, as I've never hunted alone so far from home. I really struggled with it, and not seeing any elk did not help my cause. How does one turn around from this? It stings, and all I can do is spend the next 12 months figuring out how to get mentally tougher, like you are when you talk about going on your long hunts. You've inspired me, but feel I still have a ways to go to get to that level. Many people talk about the physical aspects of these solo do-it-yourself hunts, but not much on the mental side. Not trying to be a whiner, but needed to vent and maybe get some advice. Thanks again, as always, for your time." So I think there's some things to unpack there. You know, a lot of us prepare, like I said, year round to get out and do these hunts. So I think there's a lot to unpack there. A lot of us spend all year getting ready for these hunts. And being mentally prepared, I think goes hand in hand with physically prepared. You can't have one without the other, really. Mm-hmm. Well, I do know some dudes that don't do any physical prep. They're just
mental.
They're just mental beasts.
Yeah.
And their bodies fall apart and they're wrecked and their whole time they're limping and their back hurts and their mm-hmm. muscles are sore and they're inflamed. And they're just going to do whatever it takes.
Well, look at ultra marathon runners, guys that run 100-mile races. Yeah. The average age of the people that actually complete it are like people in their 40s or older, isn't it?
Yeah.
And if you're below 25, you're less likely.
Yeah, it turns out that endurance athletes, some of these ultra marathon types, that older athletes outperform young athletes. Mm-hmm. Not because their bodies are physically tougher. It's really not it. It's a mental issue.
Mm-hmm.
And I think
look at Truett and his dad. Do you think Cameron Haynes is that much tougher than his son Truett or more fit than Truett is right now?
I think that's a perfect example because
was what, 7 miles short from that 100?
I think 10 or 10? Something. I can't remember.
It was like 91 miles.
They ran
or
a 100-mile race.
Mm-hmm.
Cam whipped it out.
And then played cheerleader for Truett.
Yeah. And Truett, didn't have whatever, the physical, mental fortitude to pull those last 10 miles. Or maybe it was 6. I don't know.
It wasn't much.
He was just shy of it. And I remember listening to that podcast that Cameron Haynes did with Joe Rogan. And Cam was like,
I'm proud of my son.
Yeah. I mean, look, dude, he ran something like 90 miles in a short window. He's like, who does that? Who can do that? It's impressive, but it ain't 100.
Which is so savage.
Which is savage.
But and 800.
The sad thing
I bet the next day Truett went out and ran another 10 miles.
No, he didn't run for like a year after that.
Oh, really?
I don't know. I haven't talked to Truett in a while. But yeah, the thing is, Cam was mentioning, the problem with trying to run 100 miles, but you quit at 90, is that next time you try to accomplish it, you got to get to the 90 first so you can get to that last 10. So it's a daunting deal. You can't tell, if you can get to, like, it's funny because that last 10 miles is the hardest 10, right? But you can't get to that till you've done a monumental accomplishment with the 90 miles, Like, look, there's no way in hell I'm running that. I mean, I'm mentally tough.
Yeah.
But I mean, Truett, dude, beast, freak.
Or what, 4,000 pull-ups?
He's the new world record pull-up holder. He beat David Goggins. Which I'm going to say he has the physical advantage as Truett's muscular from the waist up and skinny from the waist
down. He's built like a triangle.
He's
a triangle on legs.
Yeah. Mental toughness is something I've read about quite a bit with some of these athletes. And one of the things that they mention is as you get older, it's not just that you're mentally tough because you're used to physical pain. Some of the theories I've read on this have to do with the fact that you've lost loved ones, that you've gone through financial turmoil, that life's just kicked you in the teeth way more.
I always told people, especially when I was dating really hard, I want someone who life's kind of kicked down a little bit.
Yeah.
They're just more fun. They're more interesting and they're tougher.
Yeah. I think someone who gets kicked and beat up and life gives them cancer and they overcome it and things like that. Every time you're presented with a challenge in life, every time you have an obstacle in front of you, you have the opportunity to transcend that or let it keep you down and push you a different way. Mm-hmm. So you can either become more jaded, more weak, more of a quitter as a result of those hard times, or you can be the person that breaks through those barriers and keeps winning. And depending on the type of person you decide to be, and depending on each of those obstacles, it's not like just somebody that's 45 can outrun a 20-year-old on an endurance race. That 45-year-old will have to have overcome all these things in life, dealt with those pains and those losses and just what life hands you and overcome them. Someone, you can look at people who quit 30 years ago on life. They're just a victim.
something happened to them, and they have made that moment. I mean, their life revolves around something that happened decades ago.
Right. When you read Goggins' book, you know, and he is, what, 300 pounds, something like mm-hmm. that, overweight, drinking multiple Diet Coke things a day and eating garbage food and watching TV and just a pathetic loser, super fat. And, you know, he kind of just gave up. He had quit on life. That's what I'm talking about. He could have gone down that road the rest of his life, which I think scares the hell out of him. You can tell in his book, like, there was a part of him that he knows could have just, that could have been his life, his whole life.
Well, when you're in that kind of a place, I've been in some dark places like that, and really, like, you're on your way to killing yourself. I mean, the lifestyle he's living, it has an end, and it comes faster than if you were to live a harder life.
Yeah, discipline equals freedom, as mm-hmm. Jocko says, which if you're disciplined in how you eat, you have the freedom to do more with your body. If you have the discipline, you know, to get up and go to work, you have more financial freedom. Like, all these disciplines, disciplined lifestyle choices, they do grant you with a greater degree of freedom down the road or in the long run. But getting back to elk hunting in the mountains after all that prep and quitting. So I think one thing I wanted to go over today a little bit was just kind of my own experience, okay? First of all, there's these different sayings like, when you feel like quitting, remember why you started. The other one that I say all the time and my daughter quotes back to me constantly.
Is this the quote that she gave you during that elk film?
Yeah. Pain is temporary. Mm-hmm. Quitting lasts forever. I would say I say that a lot. Pain is temporary. Quitting lasts forever. Anytime I want to quit, I think about it, because I guarantee you, like this fellow here, this friend of mine that wrote me that note, had he endured the pain for 4 or 5 days and still come home without an elk, he would have known that
his coming home would have been different.
Yeah, I remember Anthony telling me this many times, especially on hunts, because Anthony is my buddy Anthony. We grew up together since we were kids, high school and beyond. Anthony is notorious for killing on the last day. Like, I swear he can't get it done unless it's the last hour of the last day.
I was thinking when you were talking about this, about when he was saying he went home and he had 5 or 6 days, and I was thinking, how many big game animals have you personally shot the last hour of the last day?
So many. Like
a dozen?
Right, and if you hang out with hunters that get it done, like Ryan Lampers.
Mm-hmm. Last hour, last day.
He's just like, it's uncanny, like it'll be the last day mm-hmm. and of the season. And he's passed on lesser animals that would be great animals, but not what he's looking for. And he's calm, like, I still have a whole day. Like, I've got all day tomorrow. Like, he more or less just, I think from years and years and years of experience. Mm-hmm. And the same is true for Anthony, and the same is true for me now. I just feel as though I'm going to hunt until the last hour, the last day, because a hunt can change in the blink of an mm-hmm. eye and go from this is never going to happen.
It's dead
to success.
Water. Yep.
And I think especially with archery elk, you know, I've been on hunts where nothing happens for 8 days. Nothing. Mm-hmm. Nothing. You're not even close to making this happen. And then all of a sudden, on day 9, the biggest bull just stands in front of you at 10 yards and you smoke it. Like, it's just done.
Yeah.
And you go from, this is never going to work, to, I did the thing. Mm-hmm. I did it. And I think because I have that experience, maybe, and because I've decided, okay, this sucks, but what else am I going to do? Because I'm not going to quit. You know, you and I, we grew up in the LDS church. We're both of the Mormon faith. And in our church, you get married for what we say is eternity. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not like till death do us part. We're like, okay, we're in this thing.
We're a little hardcore.
And the idea of divorce from the moment I decided to marry my wife has never, ever, 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 ever been an option in my mind. Period. I'm in it forever, no matter what. I will never quit. And she came to the table with the same attitude. Never going to quit. Never going to quit. When two people come together with that commitment, there's no way I'm going to quit. No matter what happens, I'm not going to quit. You approach that marriage in a different way than, I hope this works out, but if it doesn't, it doesn't. And
how
we can go a different way.
How many people get married like that? And you're just
like, well, I think most people today, I think it's more common. Mm-hmm. And I'm just saying that because we started with that commitment, it's like the divorce is not an option. Splitting up is not an option. We treated the relationship differently. When it wasn't going well, or it wasn't going well on my end or her end, we addressed it. We worked on it. I'm like, I'm stuck with this person. Like the backing out is not an option. Find solutions. You find ways to make it work. You find ways to fall deeper in love because of that commitment at the outset. So when you go on an elk hunt and you're like, from day one, going home early is not an option. You're like, I will hunt till the last hour of the last day of my hunt. No matter what, you approach the whole thing differently. It's like you don't even get to the part where you entertain the idea of leaving because you've already pre-made the decision. It was like when we were growing up and mom would be like, are you going to do marijuana? Are you going to smoke dope? And are you going to do meth and cocaine? And it was like, or drink, you know, at a party underage, like what are you going to do? You're going to sleep with a chick before you're married. Like all those sort of vices or temptations that a young man has. She was like on it day one. And she was like, she wanted your commitment then. Like, so when the opportunity came, it wasn't like, am I undecided on this?
You want to have your mind made up before the situation
arises. Oh, the mind was made up when I was like four. She was like on me like white on rice. And so it was like when the alcohol was offered to me to party in school, I had just made the decision early in life. I'm never going to drink ever in my whole life. I've just made the choice. And you know what? It's never been a challenge not to. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. People enjoy alcohol, and I've enjoyed watching people enjoy alcohol. I've been the designated driver. But it is it can be a destructive substance, like anything in excess. And I decided I didn't want to invite it into my life at all. And I don't feel like I've really lost anything. But like I said, the decision was made before the moment ever came in front of me. And once that decision is made, the commitment is worked through. It's much easier to just, when that comes, no, I'm not going to do that. So when I go out on a hunt, I have my days. I have 10 days. This is my cutoff. This is my very last day. And the season ends on this day. I'm like, all right, those are my days. I'm staying till that last hour of that last day.
Well, okay. So I want to hear what your self-talk is. Say you have a 2-week long trip. It's day 12 out of 14. You've got 2 days left and you have those voices coming into your head that are saying, you know, there's a Wendy's like 10 miles. You can go home a little bit early. What's your self-talk look like?
Different things come into my head, but one of them is I can have a Wendy's when I'm done. I can have Wendy's every day, which I haven't eaten at Wendy's, by the way, in like 12 years, but
I'm throwing out an example.
I'm just saying like a burger and fries.
Yeah.
You know, I'll starve for 2 days if I run out of food just to stay there. I will, cause I feel like 2 days, I don't care what the misery, pain, heart, it will be over in 2 days, right? Like it's over in 2 days. Then I have 300 days to think about this thing. So I don't want to quit because I don't want to deal with, so this friend of mine, one thing to keep in mind is he quit, right? And he's ashamed, embarrassed, frustrated, angry at himself even.
Or she is.
Right. Because of the quitting. Mm-hmm. And I think, and don't get me wrong, I have quit, right? So I know how he feels. I've been in his position before. Mm-hmm. One of my friends, Corey Miller, who worked at XXX Archery, now works at PSE. I love Corey. And one time we were talking about a friend of mine who kept missing in the moment, like with the bow, get the book, everything's, and he'd miss. And Corey said, someday he'll get so angry at himself for missing that he's not going to miss. And I think that's exactly true. Sometimes you get so angry at yourself for failing or quitting, that you stop failing. You're just like, you're done. You're done being that guy. It's almost cathartic in the way of making a shot. You miss, let's say, and I know a lot of guys are in this boat this year. You had the bull of your dreams and steps up, buck, whatever, you missed. You missed multiple times. And you're so mad at yourself. You're like, I can make this 30-yard shot all day long.
Chip shot.
And yet on this animal, I choked. There's no other explanation. Well, you get mad enough about that failure over and over and over, and it propels you, it drives you to figure it out, to get better, to overcome it. It haunts you. It truly haunts you. I have so, you know, right now I feel like I want to slay the world just to make up for all the failures I experienced in the previous 20 years. Like, there's something somewhat cathartic or therapeutic about making it happen, bow and arrow in hand, you know, or in rugged conditions, late season, rifle, whatever, like finding that giant mule deer. Like, there's a lot of anger and frustration with myself in previous generations that I feel like is being like addressed with the commitment and drive that I have now. But so I just think, like Caitlin said to me, my own daughter, pain is temporary, quitting lasts forever. That was a quote, I believe, by Lance Armstrong, or someone probably said it before him, but it's attributed to him. The other one is, you know, when you feel like quitting, remember why you started. The other thing that goes through my mind is, I dreamt about this all year. I prepared all year. I did all these things all year round. And now I'm going to quit early? That's hard too. So I tell myself that. Another one that I tell myself is, you know, I will probably succeed if I stay. Like, I tell myself, I'm optimistic every day. I know all I got to do is stay in the game. Keep moving around, keep looking, keep exercising my skill, keep pushing the limits of, you know, my hunting knowledge, experience, and ability. Just keep staying in the game and never quit. Like, if I can stay in the game, something will probably happen. But if you're not there, if you're on your couch at home, nothing's going to happen. If you're in your tent, just laying there wallowing in misery, it's not going to happen. You get out and I have faith that if I just, you know, get out there, something's going to happen. It could turn it in a dime. And almost always it does. That's the crazy thing is, half of it's just time.
Yeah.
Just if you can, the more days that you're able to put in, exponentially, your odds of success go up exponentially.
Last year, I took my wife Daisy on her first ever elk hunt, and we had spike tags. So it's a needle in a haystack in this unit trying to find a spike. And it's day five. Pretty much every spike in that unit got shot day one. We got out there late. We could hear like gunshots going off everywhere. They were all shot like the first night. And we didn't see an elk for 5 days. Could not see one. And then we finally spotted a herd of elk. So we get out to this little finger and we're sitting on the edge. And we hear a hunter bugling. And I'm like, that is the worst bugle I have ever heard. That dude needs to stop. Those elk are not reacting to him at all. They do not like it. And he just kept bugling for like 45 minutes straight. And he's walking towards us. And I'm like, I don't know what this guy's thought process is, what he's going to do. And we're sitting there, and this gigantic 6-point just walks right out of the bush 40 yards from us and is walking straight at us. We didn't see an elk for 5 days. Daisy was done. She does not like hiking, it turns out. And that's what mostly elk hunting is. It's sitting, which she's not a fan of. And looking through binoculars and glassing, she's not a fan of. But she was a fan of having that elk walk out and almost step on her.
Yeah, I mean, staying in the game is a big part of it, just putting in the time. So the other thing, the one thing I tell myself the most, and I don't know why, it just works for me. I just say, it's just work. Mm-hmm. It's just work. Work never killed anybody. It's just work. Which isn't exactly true. I mean, there were concentration camps and stuff. But generally, work doesn't kill it. Like, hard things, mm-hmm. it's just hard. It's just work. And when I tell myself that, it's just, I just chalk it up to putting in a day of hard labor.
You know? I tell myself, I've done hard things.
Yeah.
I've done harder things than this. I've been through worse than this.
Yeah. It's just work. It's just one foot in front of the other, one climb, one load. It's just work. You pace mm-hmm. it, you do it, you go through it. I think being disciplined in fitness, it absolutely plays a role, because elk hunting is a physical mm-hmm. Challenge. It's not just mental, but it's extremely physical. So being as in shape as you can be is a big part, I think, of being successful on a general tag, kind of mm-hmm. over-the-counter, public land kind of elk hunt. I have found that when I'm out hiking and I'm fairly fit, right? I'm in good shape. When you have a exercise routine, okay? And so I did CrossFit for a long time with my brother-in-law, Bryce. He just had a ghetto pavilion in his front yard, and we threw weight down in the rain in Oregon and climbed ropes in his front yard and did all kinds of crazy.
All the equipment's like half rusted.
Yeah, looks
like
it's all good. It's ghetto. After a couple of years of that, but we kept each other. Like, we were competitive with each other. He was good at the opposite things that I was good at. Mm-hmm. So I'd do massive squats and he'd do massive deadlifts. And, you know, he was better at some of the ring work and I was better at some of the, you know, dumbbell, whatever, right? We were great. It was great. And that's how we started working out together. And he kept me accountable. I kept him accountable. We would look at, we would just log on during the day to the CrossFit main website, and then it would just have the workout of the day listed there. And then we had no idea what it was going to be because it changed every day. Mm-hmm. And then we had to improvise because we didn't have all the gear necessary to do whatever it said that day. But then we would just both go at it and see if we could do it. And these workouts were grueling. They were tough. And so that was really good for the two of us. Later, after a couple of years, I went to a CrossFit gym just because I got invited with a buddy. I was like, sure. We went there. People were cool. Owner was cool. I was like, man, this place is fun. And it was really laid back. Not like a real strict mm-hmm. gym, because Keith isn't a strict guy. So I really liked the owner, and it was a bunch of bikers and sort of first responders, cops and policemen and firemen and military. And then just, purple haired freaks and bikers. And it was funny because up the road where I lived, you had the Oregon City CrossFit gym, which was more posh. Everybody drove a Beamer. It just didn't fit me, man. Then I go down to Happy Valley and it was like, all the ghetto, tough people. Every word was a swear word that popped out in that gym. The music was more my style. It wasn't a lot of soccer moms. You know, not that I have anything against soccer moms. But I really enjoyed going there. And those people there pushed me harder than I even did with just Bryce and I, my brother-in-law. And then those workouts are a mental test on a daily basis. All right. Every day I went to the gym, it was just mental to get there. Mm-hmm. But then when you were there, it was a mental challenge to complete the workout because they're all tough. The one thing about a sort of CrossFit style workout, it's like a HIIT style workout, high intensity, you know, training kind of workout, interval training. What happens with that is the workout's always hard. You know why, Brent? Because every workout is prescribed for you to give your maximal effort. So it doesn't matter how good a shape you're in, because every time you do the workout, you're there to push that workout to its maximum speed and loading. Mm-hmm. And so you don't ever get a break. Like, it's never like, oh, today's tries and buys, and then you do this and you lift. And no, it's like, you lay it all on the floor and you fall on the ground in a writhing ball of sweat, you know? And what happens is when you do that day after day, right? You realize pain is just pain. like physical pain, you develop a resilience against the misery. I think it's like what Navy SEALs do in BUDS, you know, they just grind them and grind them and grind them and grind them until the guys quit, and the guys that don't just get tougher, you know. And what you end up with is just guys that are, that can deal with pain and misery. And so I think we talked about this earlier offline. You did the Wim Hof thing for almost a year.
Where we moved.
Every day Brent would go outside and in the cold, freezing, like ice water, underground well.
We had this little spring that was popping up and it was fed off a glacier.
Mm-hmm.
And so the water came out like 34, 35 degrees.
It was cold.
Yeah.
And there was a little body of water. And then Brent would go every morning and do the Wim Hof, which was just submerge yourself in ice cold water for 20 minutes.
I got up to 45.
40 minutes.
I got up to 40. After the 15 minute mark, it gets real zen. Like you're just like,
and you can't help but have a breathing routine and just
yeah. Oh, when you get into water, it changes how you breathe immediately. It's like,
yeah. Well, I think that my point is when you get into an ice cold water, like ice cold, and it's snowy outside on the ground, and now you're getting in naked, more or less, or your bathing suit up to your neck, or that right there, every fiber of your being is screaming to get out of the water. It's the most, there's fewer things more uncomfortable. If you're an athlete and you sprained an ankle and you had to put it in an ice bucket, it's like, you're just like, just trying to like get through it. It's once it goes numb, it's not as bad, right? Mm-hmm. But that process of it going ice cold and kind of losing feeling, every bit of your body is like, just get out, just quit every second. And what you were able to do by going in there every day and committing to that, you mentioned, it was kind of a test for you. You mentioned how it changed your mindset toward self-discipline.
Well, a lot of it, actually, I've been thinking about it since we started this podcast. It's a lot of self-talk.
Mm-hmm.
You have to talk yourself into getting in, and then you have to talk yourself into staying in. Real fast, after about 2 weeks, getting in was not hard. I could march myself in there, turn around. I had my nice little spot where I'd gotten some sand poured so it wasn't muddy. And so I just get out to my spot and I would kneel down, and I didn't listen to those other voices, the ones that were saying, get out, this hurts.
Yeah,
this is
shut
cold,
up.
This is pain. You don't listen to them. That's what the breathing really came into place. Cause then cause you do a box breathing and there's four steps to it. You breathe in for X amount, you hold for X amount, you exhale for X amount, and then you don't breathe at all for X amount. And you can change that number depending on, I had to bring it down a little bit because like I said, short lungs or small lungs, but focusing on the breath rather than my body was key. And then once you got out of it, you'd go home and now I'm not going to have pancakes for breakfast. I'm going to ignore that part of my body that's going to say that. I need to go out and I need to go exercise. I'm not going to listen to that part of myself that doesn't want to do that. Once you can start your day, especially if you're just working on a day-to-day basis, because I really started Wim Hof when I was in a really bad place, like do or die kind of situation. I needed to get my life back on track or I was going to be dead in a gutter in a matter of weeks.
Right.
And so I was having to go just like the AA says, one day at a time. And then you take it 1 hour at a time. Sometimes it's 1 minute at a time. Being able to start the day off by getting in that water and just breathing and ignoring the other part of me, let me continue doing that throughout the day. So then breakfast come around. I'm not going to eat those pancakes. Yeah. I'm going to eat some protein. I am going to go work out. I'm going to ignore that part of me that wants to go take a nap. I'm not going to go hang out with that sleazy girl. I'm going to ignore that part of me, right. You know?
And, you know, one of my favorite podcasts I listened to, only the first 5 or 10 minutes, by the way, was Jocko Willink at the Tim Ferriss podcast. Tim was out of town or whatever, like he does, and he invited Jocko to speak to his audience. And Jocko shows up, and he basically reads a study about how discipline and willpower, really willpower is finite. You only have so much, and then once it's gone, you're doomed. You're doomed to fail. And he's like, folks, I'm here to tell you that is absolute garbage. Okay. And you read all these scientific studies, and then he's just like, no, sorry. All these doctors and all these scientists, for all their PhDs, they don't know what the hell they're talking about. I live this. Mm-hmm. Discipline begets more discipline. Discipline brings you freedom. And the idea that you build on that, you hear other people say it too. I did a podcast with Corey Jacobson years ago on a Navy SEAL who said, make your bed. Every morning, just make your bed. That's all it was the simple act of making your bed. But by getting up in the morning and the first thing you do is you make your bed, you start doing other things that are disciplined as well.
Yep.
And that was Jocko's contention. He's like, I'm sorry. The more discipline you exercise, the more discipline you develop. It's not the other way around. It's not what these PhDs are saying. It's not the more discipline you develop, the more willpower gauge disappears and then you're hosed. Mm-hmm. It's not like that.
If it was like that, no one would ever be able to overcome an addiction.
No one would be able to overcome anything, right?
Anything.
Like, yep. It's the other way. Little by little. Jordan Peterson says, clean your room. Yep. That basic act of cleaning your room and keeping it clean builds a base level of discipline that then, and cleaning your room is harder than anyone could imagine. Like having a clean room and keeping it clean and organized deliberately, then flows into the rest of your life.
I think I'm 32 or 31, one of those.
Mm-hmm.
And cleaning my room to this day is still one of the keeping it clean to this day is still a struggle for me.
Yeah. Well, I think that's why when Peterson mentions it, he's like, this is no trivial thing.
Mm-hmm.
I challenge you, you know, get your room clean and keep it in order. And you'll find that that discipline begets more discipline, just like the Wim Hof every day. Mm-hmm. Then set your stage for that day for you to stay on track with other things. I think this is the same thing with exercise. When you have an exercise routine, it sets the stage, that discipline, going to the gym, just showing up, doing the workout, whatever. It ripples into everything else. You're like, I'm not going to eat that donut. I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to do that. Because you don't listen to those voices. Each time you're able to shut down those voices. So you ask me when I'm on the mountain and I have those voices come, what do I do to them? You know, what do I say to myself? Well, generally, yeah, I don't listen to those voices.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have a foothold. They're just not an option.
I think you subconsciously or without realizing it, you shut them down.
Oh, for sure.
I
think I deliberately shut them down for years, but it also goes back to this. I think it was, it might have been Leif Babin. Is that his name?
Leif Babin.
Babin.
Which, by the way, have you seen him? Because he looks like a soccer dad. Like,
right.
You hear his voice. I'm Leif Babin. Yeah. I'm a Navy SEAL for 30 plus. Like, he sounds like he should look like Megatron.
Or Jocko.
Yeah. Yeah. And he does not.
So I think it was him. I can't recall, but I think it was him talking about this. But it was a SEAL. And he was saying, I am not the most fit guy. I'm not the best at the Navy SEAL buds, like getting through it. You know, a lot of times I was, you know, middle or last on these different activities. And so there were other dudes who were far more fit, blessed with bodies, far more capable, blessed with genetics that just can do these things, and they would quit. And one of the things that came up for a lot of these guys when they ask them, you know, how did you get through it? An answer I have heard many, many times is this: quitting wasn't an option. I decided before I ever made it, before I ever went to the buds training, they're like, I decided I was either going to die or get through. I was never going to ring the bell. The bell was just not going to happen. Just period. Mm-hmm. Nope. I'm going to die first. I'm not going to do it. Just like I said, when I went into my marriage, never quitting.
Mm-hmm.
When you go in with I'm never going to drink alcohol, like I've made that decision, boom, it's over. So when they went into buds, it wasn't like, I hope I get through it. We'll see what happens. I think, you know, I'll figure it out. Hopefully I can. I'm pretty tough. Let's see where this test takes me, right? That leaves that window. That leaves that door open for quitting, for those voices to come in to say, maybe you weren't made for this.
the door was shut, nailed, and boarded up before you ever walked into the situation.
Exactly. So quitting wasn't an option. So the bell never tempted them. The thoughts never came in their head. They never even went down that road. Believe you me, every time I am out, and especially when success is evading me at every turn, and I'm tired and I'm hungry, I'm
haven't bathed in 2 weeks.
When things are at their lowest and you're just beat down, you've been out there for a long time. One of the things that goes through hunters' heads, all of them, is why am I doing this to myself? Mm-hmm. Why am I here? This is not fun. This is not rewarding. I could be doing so much more productive things with my life.
Yeah, you spent 2 weeks out in the woods and you changed nothing about your life.
And you're kind of, I feel this is kind of a meaningless activity in a way. And you can get in your head real quick and you can be like, why do I do this? Why? Those thoughts are those thoughts that you can't entertain, that shouldn't be in your head at all. Because those are the thoughts that are like, this is dumb. You know, I'm using vacation time to be out here and accomplish nothing when I could be on a vacation with my family. Mm-hmm. Now, you had a lot of clarity for 300 days, 340 mm-hmm. days.
A desire.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden you're up there on day 8 and you're like, why am I doing this? Right? The point is, and Anthony says this a lot of times, he'll be like, your hunt is 7 days long. Your whole hunt is 7 days long. You can make up those 7 days. You know, that excuse doesn't really work. Mm-hmm. When you're like, why do I do this? This is stupid. That's just your weakness telling you to quit. Mm-hmm. That's it. It's just your weakness. And I'll say that I've said this a lot. Elk hunting for me is not particularly, it's not on the fun scale. Mm-hmm. It's a type 2 fun, not a type 1 fun. There's not a lot of enjoyment that comes mm-hmm. from elk hunting, at least over the counter kind of general tag, mm-hmm. public land, trying to get it done, backpacking, you know, succeeding on that level in that kind of country on highly, you know, crowded hunting areas. It's hard. Now, it is type 1 fun when you're out on some private land and you got the hundreds of elk running around you, like that elk ops year I mm-hmm. went, and I was just like, I saw elk stuff I'd never seen. That was just a hoot. And then in the afternoon, you get sandwiches, hang out, joke around in a cabin, blah, blah, blah. And then you head back out and you're chasing elk. Yeah, that was type 1 fun, bro. Mm-hmm. That was really fun. Not super hard. And the success afterward doesn't carry the same weight. Mm-hmm. It doesn't have the same meaning. What I do now is hard, but when I get home, there's a certain, it changes me as a man. Mm-hmm. There's a certain like toughness that I develop and a type 2 reward that comes from it, where I walk away from it going, this was a very meaningful activity. It forms me, it challenges me as a person, and it hones a character and a strength that the other one doesn't. As a hunter, I like to balance the two because, mm-hmm. dude, it's fun to just go sit on some whitetail property, get in mm-hmm. a tree stand and see giant bucks run around, and then come back in the afternoon, have sandwiches, hang out, go in the evening and just joke for a week and be with your buddies and your dad. That's fun.
Yeah.
Going up, you know, 30 miles, averaging like a 20-mile hike to get to where you want to go, doing 17 miles per day, being cold, wet, and eating backpack food, you know, not seeing anything day upon day upon day, and just being physically ground down. Like, I love it now, but there were a lot of years where I was like, where that was a mental grind. But there's a different kind of fun. And so that's another thing that goes through my mind is, you know, hey, I know it's not going to be really enjoyable in the moment. It's going to have highs and lows. But if I can pull it off and come home with all that meat and that success, that experience, man, that's deep. That's deep. And so that's something I'm telling myself when I'm out there. Let's get back to being on the mountain. There are times where the alarm is going off at 5 a.m. You know, I got to bed at midnight. There's only so many days left in the season. You know, and it's like you can't afford to let a morning, you know, not to get up, but you're exhausted. Again, I go back to It's just work. It's just pain. It's just discomfort. Like, who cares? It's not going to stop me. And then that alarm goes off. I just start going through the motions. I mix up some Ignite, maybe a Blaze shot.
Yep.
Ryan has some coffee. I start rolling out. I get up. When it's cold, it is really, really nice to have a fire.
Yeah.
Because that's kind of a bit of a game changer. And I think that's a good segue into this next thing that I want to talk about. And that is tactical strategies, not mental, but like little things you can do
to help stay on the mountain,
to help you stay on the mountain. Because I find that, you know, you're not just a spiritual, emotional, mental being. Mm-hmm. You have a physical being. Mm-hmm. And it's very real, the needs of your physical biology, right? And the more that you can address your physical biology and its needs and all of that, the more your mental game can stay sharp too. So I feel like, you know, the best of the best are going to have such a tough mental game. They're going to rise above just about any and all physical, biological, you know, weaknesses. But the more you can, you know, take care of those biological needs, the more, and some mental, the more you're going to be able to handle it. Okay. And so, especially let's say you're hunting with a young person, they've not done a lot of hunting. They're not used to the misery and they're not as keen on the success as you are, willing to sacrifice as much mm-hmm. as you are. They're like, it's just a deer, Dad, you know? So think of it that way. But for you, when you take them out, you want them to be warm. You know, mm-hmm. you want to help them endure it the best they can by taking care of some creature comforts for them so that mm-hmm. they can endure what is going on. You know, we're such a spoiled, civilized world today that any level of discomfort, some people they've spent years in a temperature controlled room, only being cold from the front door to the car and, mm-hmm. and only dealing with hunger on a very minimal level
yeah.
and only pushing their bodies to a very minimal level. And so that's very difficult for someone in that situation to then go and endure the sort of discomfort and hardship that is required on a mountain hunt. Some things that I think are that help me stay out there, fire. Mm-hmm. Fire is huge. A teepee and a stove. Those things are essential when things get cold or are just wet. Maybe it's not that cold, but it's just everything's wet. Mm-hmm. So then it becomes cold because you're wet. Having fire in a teepee is game changing. It completely changes your endurance, your ability to kind of relax, to recharge before you go back out and do your thing. Getting up in the morning when it's 10 degrees, or like last year got down to -5, -10. When it's that cold, having a fire that you can just roll in your sleeping bag and stoke, and then mm-hmm. boom, you can get naked in that teepee. Yep. It's so warm. You know, being able to have fire is major. The other one is food. Okay. Mm-hmm. No one wants to eat a Cliff Bar breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Like
that sounds like a voice of experience.
Or Power Bar. Those Power Bars were the worst.
No, the worst was the Tiger Milk Bars. Have you ever had?
Oh yeah. Those were all my generation. We were backpacking at Eagle Caps with those. It was awful. So that's another one. You know, you don't want to be eating that stuff. That food really, in a diverse amount of food and tasty food, healthy food, nutritional food, but foods you enjoy eating that you never get tired of or you rarely get tired of, those are critical things for you to really.
Evolutionarily speaking, up until the last 200 years, 90% of human beings' time was spent gathering food.
And water.
We are very food-oriented creatures.
Yeah. So I feel like
variety of food.
Yeah, food.
Tasty food.
Fire. Those are two things that really help. And when I'm solo, there's just something about caveman TV, which is just fire. like building your stove, mm-hmm. getting it hot, and you're just sitting there in a warm teepee.
I can watch fire for hours.
And you're just watching the fire, and there is something therapeutic and just, you know, that feels good about it. Mm-hmm. So that helps dramatically. Now, in September, a lot of times it's so warm, you don't need a fire.
But it's still comfort.
Toward the late season, you know, if you're there the last 2 weeks in Colorado or a high mountain hunt somewhere, mm-hmm. and it's raining and it's damp and the season is changing and all the leaves are falling, dude, fire is nice. Mm-hmm. And, you know, shameless plug for Seek Outside, but you get 5% off
5%
when you use this code Gritty at Seek Outside. Mm-hmm. But with a Cimarron, it's like 1.5 pounds. And with this, with a titanium U-turn stove, it's like, I can't remember.
It's under like 2.5 pounds.
Under 2 pounds, I think.
Yeah.
You're looking at a 3.5 pound total system. And if you're sharing it with a dude who's with you, you're each carrying 1.5, mm-hmm. 1.75 pound, like 3/4 pounds. I mean, it's like,
it's nothing.
Big deal. But even solo, it's not
still,
a,
yeah.
you know, a lot of one man tents are 2.5 pounds. Mm-hmm. So you're right about the same weight, 2.5.
I'm willing
pounds.
To sacrifice a couple more ounces for a lot more comfort. Like I like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
That Microlite bottle. Mm-hmm. I love having hot stuff.
Yeah. So, you know, having that kind of shelter system is, mm-hmm. is a big, game changer for staying
food.
Up on the mountain.
What about, drink stuff? So a lot of times you drink it out of a wallow or something, especially
during
September.
I have a lot of different drink mixes, tons, mm-hmm. because I find that the more I hunt, the longer I'm up there, the more hydration that I need. Mm-hmm. And so I do all sorts of electrolytes from all over. I use the Mountain Ops. I do the liquid IV. I do like Myo drops or Nun tablets or like you name it. I go through the, I have it all, you know, I have assortments. I love Pedialyte. Mm-hmm. I take Pedialyte with me, the little packets, especially once I've pushed myself so hard that everything I eat is kind of having trouble digesting. You know, it's like an endurance race sometimes for 2 days. Maybe we just do some grueling. I can't really eat solid foods sometimes, and I got to switch over to just Pedialyte, mm-hmm. and shop blocks and a little bit of sugar and be honey stinger waffles. Like I'm mm-hmm. just like eating, you know, sugar, like you would if you had diarrhea and you were really sick, mm-hmm. and you're giving a kid like really mild, straight up like liquid diet and
yeah.
some easy digestion. And then after a day or two, I'll get back my feet back under me and I'm back to eating my normal meals. But I got to pay attention to what my guts are telling me when I'm pushing myself that hard. It only happens now and then, like, you know, when you really, you're running up a mountain chasing mm-hmm. this or that, and you're packing out and you get back at, you know, 4 a.m. and you get back up and you go out again the next day, shoot something else. And now you're mm-hmm. packing that. And it's just like, boom, 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 like all in a row, no sleep and at high exertion. I lose 10 pounds. I get skinny. But I think it's good for the body and the mind to push like that. Mm-hmm. And when I get done, you know, I recover quickly. But having lots of electrolyte mixes and drinks and stuff really help me with get through that kind of stuff. And everybody's different. You know, Lampers needs different things than I do. Different kind of diet, different strategies.
So we've got fire/shelters. Mm-hmm. Good food that we want to eat all the time and drink mixes.
Yeah.
Those are three pretty simple things that you're going to have with you no matter what.
So the other thing that I do when, and I know some guys are going to find this blasphemous, but whatever, you do you, I do me. I have 2 sets of earbuds, Bluetooth earbuds, mm-hmm. that, and they last forever. Charge, and the little container they come in is a charger mm-hmm. as well, so you can keep recharging those little earbuds. And what I do is I put, before I go on a hunt, I download a number of podcasts I want to listen to from different outlets and different people, and then I download a bunch of books, audiobooks that I want to take in over the course of this month or two, right? And so I have a whole assortment of audiobooks and podcasts for listening to. And then I have a little bit of music that I might want to tune into on some days. And especially when I'm solo, I'm a multitasker kind of guy. Like, I want to accomplish more than one thing at a time. Mm-hmm. Especially if you, I have a real addiction for feeling productive. And so if I'm just sitting there glassing hour after hour after hour after hour, I do enjoy my alone time. I do enjoy just thinking about things, and I'll spend days just thinking and not listening to a single thing. But when I've kind of exhausted that, I want to learn something. Mm-hmm. So I listen to one of those audiobooks, and it could be historical. It could be fiction, like a Jack Carr novel or something, which I often save for hunts. Mm-hmm. And definitely I have some fiction writers that I really enjoy listening to, and it depends on my mood, and I will study or research. Like, The River of Doubt is a great one I listened to on a hunt years ago. Ranella's book, Meat Eater, I really enjoyed that. I remember listening to that, I don't know, it was like 2008 or something, 9 or something, I remember. His Buffalo book, I really enjoyed. Like,
The American Buffalo?
Yeah, and over years, I listened to a lot of books, especially when I'm solo. And I put one earbud in so I can still hear out the other, you know, but I'm just kind of glassing for 4 or 5 hours straight, but I'm listening to a great story. It really does help pass the time, big time. And then when I get back to my tent at night and I'm all alone, and nights, it gets dark early, right? The later the season gets. When I was solo hunting for elk last year, and I was like days and days of being by myself, I downloaded a couple of movies when I went back in for my second leg. Mm-hmm. So I had like 4 movies that I downloaded to my phone. And then at night I get my fire going, so it's nice and warm. I have some snacks, you know, some treats I saved, Rice Krispie, whatever, you know, for the end of the day, a little hot cocoa, slumber or something. And I got the fire going and I just watch a movie. And it would take your mind off of, you laugh, whatever kind of movie it is, or an action movie. Movies I had not seen, right? And I think that that gave me a little bit of civilization, you know, a little slice of it to plug into my backcountry. And it really did kind of, it's a creature comfort for sure, but it really got me rejuvenated for the next day to just get up early and go.
What movie was it you guys watched when you had your last hunt with Sly?
Yeah, there was Lampers and
James,
and we were reined in for 2 full days, mm-hmm. in just pouring rain, and we were stuck in the teepee or in the tent, and we were getting bored. And I was like, we started, like, after we kind of read our books or did our thing, I was listening to audiobooks, but then we're like, do we have any movies on anyone's phone? And I went through and I had some kid movies and different stuff, but we had the movie The Proposal on there with Sandra
That's
Bullock.
Right, The Proposal.
And Ryan Reynolds. And we sat down and watched that. Ryan had never seen it. I don't know if James had either.
Mm-hmm. I don't think either of them had.
And they were laughing their butts off, and it was a nice change of pace. We watched 2 more movies, I think, like The Patriot and Last of the Mohicans.
Ooh.
And in, I think, American Sniper. Mm-hmm. So we went through a few movies. I think we watched 3 or 4 movies that day. And it was nice. And then the next day it cleared up and we got back out in the mountains and crushed it. So I think to each their own. Maybe some guys just want to go on a sabbatical where they, you know, or some kind of monk-like, you know, unplug from civilization thing. I find I like that as well. And believe me, I just crave it. And I do that for days on end. But after a week or so, I start to be like, it's nice to plug and play, you know, mix up a little audiobook, a little education. I like to learn, you know, and then you throw in a little movie for some entertainment. And it's amazing how much more fun those hunts can be with a little prep like that, and how much easier it is to take your mind off of the misery you're in. A lot of times when I'm doing a pack out and it's just, it's just a grind and it's heavy, heavy, heavy loads and we're going a long way and we're climbing through stuff. It's incredible when you can take your mind off of it. So you throw in a little music or you listen to a good audiobook and you're just like, you're so distracted by the audiobook, you're not paying attention to your blistered feet and your burning back, and you're just like, your mind is, it's like you're not allowing those negative thoughts to even be in your head because you're distracted by these others. You know, when my wife had cancer and she was going through cancer, and mostly anyone who has been sick can relate to this. But when you're sick, Brent, you were sick with cancer, you had leukemia, and you're sick and you feel like crap. One of the leading things that people do is watch movies. Mm-hmm. Watch a TV, start a new TV series, you know.
Part of me daydreams about getting a car accident, breaking my leg so I can sit down and binge watch The Office.
Right, right.
You know?
That's like what I mean. Like, when you sit down and you listen to or watch something like that, it distracts you mm-hmm. big time from the misery that you're in. It's like your mind goes to this other place mm-hmm. and you're watching all the reruns of Friends, you know, or something. The Office, whatever it is. Stranger Things. It's a Halloween. My kids want to watch Stranger Things. They've never seen it. We're going to probably do a Stranger Things marathon, you know.
I see some of your children being great with that and others not.
Yeah, it'll be interesting. But the thing is, that distraction is powerful, you mm-hmm. know. And so I do like to listen to an audio book while I'm doing the most grueling hike imaginable, or maybe some music or something. And you know, it helps a lot.
When you say distraction,
it takes your mind off of that.
I was going to say, that's what the breathing was, the box breathing mm-hmm. that I used to do when I did the Wim Hof. It was to take my mind into another place.
And I do hunts where I don't use anything like that at all. But I have found I perform better and I enjoy the hunt more when I do. I like shop for a good book, mm-hmm. you know, before I ever go on the hunt. And I have a series of them where I'm like, man, I'm really anxious. I'm excited mm-hmm. to get into the mountains so I can like read my book.
Yeah.
It's like, I'm excited for mm-hmm. the car drive so I can catch up on some podcast episodes that I
hold off on listening to some books sometimes so I have them for those moments.
Yeah.
Like, me too. Know it's a good one. I want to listen to it.
Like Savage Son. I waited till mm-hmm. our bear hunt so I could listen to it just while I'm out there hunting bears. And I loved it, you know? So those are some of the strategies I wanted to, before I close this podcast, I wanted to share this article, which I thought was kind of interesting. And it's about, it says, sometimes people get discouraged because things don't turn out the way they had hoped. Maybe they put energy into something and it didn't work out. They tried a new business venture or to kill an elk, but they're still not able to do it. They think it's never going to happen. But one thing we have to learn is that life honors perseverance. On the way to your yes, you may encounter some no's. You may encounter some closed doors, but that doesn't mean it's the final answer. It just means keep going. Okay? So here we go. Here are six strategies to keep you going and not quitting. One, equip yourself by the power twins, faith and patience.
The power twins.
Faith and patience. Yeah. They both build confidence and strength to your character. Just because you don't see things happen right away doesn't mean you should quit. No, instead, rise up and press forward. Believe in your why. Keep hoping, because if you adopt an I won't quit mindset, you will find yourself persisting when things get tough till you achieve your goal. Remember that the bamboo plant spends 5 years just growing its roots. So the faith and patience are key. Faith in terms of, like I said before, I'm just going to go through all the motions till the last hour on the last day, because I believe if I do that, I'm probably going to succeed. So it's just, I just put in the time. I just punch the clock. Mm-hmm. I just go through the effort. I just put in the time. And because I believe that, you know, that I have faith in that process, you combine that with patience and go, may not happen today, may not happen tomorrow, but by the end of this window, it's probably going to happen. And it just takes patience. It takes that kind of, mindset. It says, the article goes on to say, stay focused and remember your why. Why? Why are you there? And I think that's a question that you need to answer before you ever go out into the mountains. Because like I said, a lot of hunters, when they get there and things are tough and it sucks, what are the things they say to themselves, Brent? It's, why am I doing this? Mm-hmm. I could be here. I could be there. I could be
doing anything.
Why? Else. Why? You need to answer that before you're on the mountain. It says, whenever you put your mind to something, it is essential to identify the reasons of why you want it. If you discover that you don't have a strong enough why for your particular goal, it is probably a good idea to get rid of it. When the going gets tough, it is your why that will keep you going. And the stronger is your why, the more likely you won't quit. I'm a competitive person. You know, I have a lot of whys for what everything that I do. But sometimes my why is because someone pissed me off and I want to prove them wrong. And it's as simple as that. Like, yeah. It's like, you told me I couldn't do it and I'm going to show you that I can. Like, that's been true my whole life. You want me to do something? Tell me I can't do it. Like, that makes me, it just propels me. I'm not sure that's the best why. That's why I say it's combined with a lot of otherwise, yeah. That I'm wise too. But you got to figure that out so that when you're up there, you don't quit. And if you look at, for example, I think if you want a lesson in never quitting and winning and conquering the world, you watch The Last Dance with Michael Jordan, the documentary, The Last Dance. And you listen to people like Kobe Bryant talk about what goes on in their brain when they're competing. You look at some of the best competitors in the world, some of their thought is basically, even Lance Armstrong, I know he was doping, but the man also had like, win at all costs, crush the competition, destroy anyone in his path.
He was also competing with other people that were doping.
Richard,
like he was the that only too. Doper.
But I,
he just doped better than everybody right, else, which he's a winner.
Right. So what I was going to say, though, is this obsession with winning, you know, this a lot of times what propels those people is the negative things that people said about someone that drives them to succeed. And I think I don't think that's an unhealthy, if it is, I'm really unhealthy. I don't talk about it much and I don't say it out loud, but I am motivated by the hate of other people toward me or people who want to see me fail in anything in life. From business to
Is this your way of shouting out saying thank you, haters?
Yeah, it's I'm just saying you can use fuel to achieve to motivation and drive.
Yeah, for sure.
It's just like when you go to the gym, what's your why? Why do you want to get into peak physical shape? You better have a good why.
She dumped me. Yeah. She's gonna want this.
Exactly. I'm telling you, like
you can use not so great motives to accomplish some things.
Now you got to be careful because I think it can twist or warp you, but for sure.
A little bit.
It says that one of the other things it says is change your strategy if need be. If the approach that you're currently using is not working, try a different approach. Again, I think that's pretty, when you're hunting, I do that all the time. You adapt. Change your perspective. The meaning of failure. If you fail as you try to achieve your goal, instead of using that failure as an excuse to quit, use it as a stepping stone. We grow through failing. By failing, we learn from our mistakes, make the necessary blah, blah, blah. And I think that's true. For certain, I had to, when I failed on a hunt I worked really hard on and I just missed. You know, I shot a foot over an animal and he got away and the season is over and it was the biggest bull of my life. Whenever that happened, I had to chalk it up as, well, probably won't happen next year or the next year because each time I learn and I grow. So all those failures are failures, yes, but you're also winning because each one of those gets you more capable the next time.
Mm-hmm. I can't remember the quote, but the quote goes something along the lines of, our character is not determined by our failures because failure is an inevitability, but our character is determined by us getting back up.
Yeah. This one, I like what it says right here. One way to stop yourself from quitting is to channel your focus into doing something else that you know you will be rewarded for. So for example, you're not finding elk. It's not happening. You're not getting, you know, the opportunities. Like my friend said, I just wasn't seeing elk and I was seeing hunters all over. So you can convince yourself that you're failing or to quit. And it says, stop yourself from quitting is channel your focus into doing something you know is rewarding. I do that all the time. I'm like, okay, there's no elk, but dude, I hiked 8 miles today with a 40-50 pound pack.
That's a win.
I mean, that's physical gains. That's you mental gains.
10 miles in.
That's a win. That's a health benefit to me. Like, I think all the time, change that focus. Well, today I traveled, you know, the course of this 5 days, I haven't seen a single elk, but guess what? I hiked a total of 50 miles.
Mm-hmm. I know it's winning. I know there's no elk in these six basins.
Yeah. And that's winning. That's winning. And change. So like you said, change, channel your focus into something, you know, that is rewarding. Right. Mm-hmm.
Cause so many people be like, I hiked 10 miles today and I didn't see a thing.
Yeah, what a waste.
What a waste.
It's like, no, that's a gain.
No, you've limited 10 miles of land.
Look at the things you learn. I keep a diary, by the way, when I hunt. On my phone nowadays, I just whip it out and I write down thoughts and ideas constantly. I document the time of day, when the wind is blowing, what I observe an animal do. Like, I have a whole diary of things that I'm observing animal behavior, and I'm observing the hunt unfold, or I'm observing my reaction in that situation, whether I was calm or not calm. And I feel like that diary adds some productivity to my hunt. It makes me feel like I'm winning as I write down all these things. And as you do that year over year, week, day after day, and you start going back and reading those things, you realize different patterns and things come together, and you become, I think, a better outdoorsman, a better hunter over time, as you start to observe and take in all these things. It's amazing what you can retain if you write it down versus you just go out and hunt, come home, and within 2 weeks in civilization, your mind is so, you forget. Mm-hmm. You forget so much. So writing it down is a big benefit. So the other thing it says is, be grateful for what you have achieved so far and believe that setbacks are temporary, which is what I just said, you know, believe that every day you gain more knowledge and insight about what works and what does not. And that means you're getting stronger and wiser. Like, no day is wasted. You know, every time you get out there, you learn that those six basins aren't ideal. You might even go back to your truck, drive 20 miles to a new spot and go hunt again. Another spot. Like, you learn these things, and the next year you won't spend your time there during that time of year. There's too much pressure. There's too much this. So it's all about, you know, continuing to learn and be grateful, like he said, for what you are getting out of the hunt. And I think that's common. Like, a lot of guys do that. They're like, I didn't kill anything. I didn't even see anything, but man, I'm grateful I was up there. I got to spend a week with a buddy. We saw bears. We did see a bobcat. You know, we got to do this, this, and this. And when you start to judge your success on more than just whether you got an animal or not, you start to realize the value of that hunt. And the trick in here is to be grateful for that. Surround yourself with family and supportive friends. I can't say that enough, because, you know, Ryan, Anthony, my cousin Ben, you, anyone, right, that's in my inner circle, I sit there and I say, you know, I know that they got my back and they're excited to see me succeed.
It's true.
And that if I quit, they'll be disappointed and they'll let me know, you know? And so,
oh yes.
And then I have a lot of friends who I motivate them. I inspire them. Mm-hmm. And so I don't want to quit because for that reason as well. Because, man, there's some sort of accountability. It's like, I don't want to let them down. I don't want to let them down. I don't want to let my kids down. Like, they're three girls that aren't as into hunting as I am, obviously, but they know what I do for a living and they expect me to go out and conquer. And I don't want to let my kids down. My wife
those kids will roast the crap out of you. They are merciless. What do you mean you came home 2 days early?
Yeah. They're not used to, they don't want to see their dad not win, you know, up on the mountain or even in work or career or anything, you know? And I think that When you feel like you're inspiring others, that's a big motivator. So surround yourself with people that are supportive or that really appreciate what you're doing. Stay away from people. Like Jordan Peterson says, surround yourself with people who are genuinely excited about your success. There were people in my life in the past where I would say, look, I got this bull. It was amazing. It was public land. And they're like, he's not as big as what I thought he'd be.
He's got really small bases.
You didn't make a perfect shot, but you still, that's cool.
You gotta track them for a day.
You track them a little bit, you know, or whatever it is, right? Mm-hmm. They look for the digs and they devalue your accomplishment any way that they can, get in your head. And those people are not excited mm-hmm. for your success. They're jealous.
Yeah. Cut them out of your life.
And they want to minimize those things, your successes. So when you have people like that in your life, you need to minimize them. Mm-hmm. You need to cut them out, minimize their involvement. Jordan Peterson was talking about another book he was coming out with, which in one of his rules is be careful who you tell your successes to.
It's not success. Isn't it your dreams?
No. I think it was your success. It could be your dreams. Mm-hmm. But what I think, it's true either way. He's saying, you know, these people will undermine your drive, motivation, your feeling of ability, you know, to succeed. Get rid of those people. They're toxic. They're not going to help you win. Get yourself surrounded by people that are genuinely excited for your success and that inspire you or are inspired by you. And there's tremendous power in that. And then finally, when you want to quit, push yourself to be consistent with your actions. Remember that just because you cannot see anything yet, this doesn't mean that nothing is happening. You may be closer to achieving your dream than you think. And I think that's very true. I always tell myself, you know, it's amazing how a hunt can go from utter zero to the most epic moment in your life mm-hmm. to that in the mountains to that moment, you know.
We had Levi Morgan on the podcast last year, and he was talking about, he thinks about 95% of people end up quitting on their dreams right when they're like feet from the finish line. They just don't know it.
Yeah.
Like he almost gave up on his bow hunting career.
Yep.
Was ready to quit, going to throw it in. And I think his dad said, you've already signed up for this one. You got to go do it.
Yeah.
And he
something
went,
like that.
Yeah, and then he ended up winning the whole thing. Dude, and made money.
That is such a good podcast, by the way. And if you haven't listened to it, you need to go back. A lot of people might have skipped that one. Go back and listen to that podcast because that man's a winner. That man is the Michael Jordan of archery.
And failure is the time to learn, episode 502.
Yeah. And I love Levi, by the way. He's just a freaking beast, amazing character. Can't say enough about, he's a winner, but he also is like just a good dude. Mm-hmm. And I don't think he is often looked to enough for information because
yeah, if you want to learn to be a better shooter, he has a YouTube channel. I don't think a lot of people realize that.
Yeah. I don't think he's pushed it very hard over the years, but it's a really good one. I think that's it, Brent. I think that kind of covers it. I hope that the audience found that useful because being able to stick it out is tough, but it's worth it. And there's no one solution here. I think there's some tactical things you can do on the mountain, like I said, between, you know, nutrition, exercise, audiobooks, fire, you know, good shelter, that kind of stuff, movies, even down to, you know, the commitment to not quit before you ever get there. I feel like that is just, it's just huge. It's huge in everything. It's huge in my marriage. You know, it's huge in, all. It's just quitting isn't an option. And when you rule the option from your life, it changes everything about how you proceed, you know, and how you win. So hope that's useful. Do us a favor. You like our show? You like what we're doing? Please share it with as many people as you can mm-hmm. because we don't exactly win on the algorithm side of things.
Yeah.
You know, we don't play the YouTube game very well or the Google or the SEO or anything like that. So your shares with your buddies, word of mouth, you know, send them a link. That's awesome. And anytime you can support us by shopping with our partners, that helps us out. Use the code Gritty at Mountain Ops. Use it at Peaks Equipment for some nice sissy sticks, trekking poles.
They've got some new toys coming out soon.
We have some new products. There's some new products they're coming out with.
Heather's Choice. Got some rack saw.
There's a sheep feet.
Sheep feet. Goat knives.
Goat knives. You can check out the e-scouting class by Mark Livesey. Treeline Pursuits. That thing is a legit course. You can find the links to all these things and the discount codes because you save at all these places. And every time you purchase there, it helps us out. You can find that in the description field of the YouTube videos of the podcast. And if you go to briancall.com, you can hit the podcast link and they're all right there. You can just go to the Gritty Brian Call YouTube channel and find the episodes there as well. And like I said, it all helps us out. We really appreciate all that support. I think that's it for today. Hope you enjoyed the show. Let us know. Leave us a comment. Like the video. It always helps us tell other people. I think it feeds the YouTube algorithm a little bit. The funny thing about it is if we produce a film, it's funny. We put a film out and YouTube will say, congratulations, your video reached 140,000 people. Mm-hmm. And you're like, oh, cool. And then they say, that's 138,000 more people than your previous video. Because our previous video was a podcast, which is video. And only a tiny fraction of people watch the videos version of the podcast. 90% of our viewership is audio through iTunes and other, you know, Spotify and stuff like that. So it messes with the algorithms because when I don't think YouTube knows what to do with seven videos in a row that are podcasts that just get 2,000 views and then hunt videos that get 100,000 views. And they're just like,
I know. We need to find someone who knows something about YouTube.
Anybody who knows something about YouTube. We have some friends out there that do YouTube. You should call us. I've considered whether I put all the videos on a different YouTube channel or not, because I feel like YouTube, if every video you drop is getting 100,000, 70,000, 50,000 views, YouTube then every time video hits that channel will probably treat it different. But when you have content that's a audio podcast but offered visually, I'm afraid that those 2,000 views make YouTube think that we're one-hit wonders every now and then, or our only good videos come out on Sundays, or I don't know. I don't know how they calculate this. But I do think all the video podcasts are probably diminishing the value of the hunt film in the algorithms. I hate playing with the algorithms anyway. I just want to put the content out. You know, that's why for us, putting out every Sunday works well. Because you just know every Sunday is a gritty
sign
Sunday.
Up for our newsletter. We send a newsletter out whenever we drop a new film.
True.
And our newsletter was down for a long time when we didn't know about it.
We are a tip-top shop here. One thing I was going to say is, on the newsletter, that really helps if you sign up. And we don't hardly ever send an email
unless
out.
There's a film.
Unless there's a video. Yeah. We should do better. It's just me and my brother, and we're what we are.
Mm-hmm. And half the team is out in the woods 6 months out of the year. So this is a very weird business that we have.
Yeah, it's different, huh? But it's fun.
We're really making it work.
The video side of the house, for those that are asking, when do we get to see videos? We're planning to release videos sometime in November. Well, no. I would say beginning December, we're going to try to start dropping movies after Thanksgiving or right around Thanksgiving every Sunday for 5 or 6 months. But some of it is very dependent on the government. And
the good old government.
We have we're going to talk about this down the road. But, you know, when you film on public land and you commercial, it's deemed commercial filming, there's all kinds of permits.
Red tape over red tape.
There's a process depending. The process is well, you can just imagine. Think of the most bureaucratic, useless government process, and it's pretty much follows that line. So we're going to talk about that a little bit because we're in the process of getting all these permits and dealing with this permit process. And it's a broken process. Mm-hmm. It's a garbage process. I'm just going to be frank. And, mm-hmm. and it's,
there's some bad laws on the book. They're a little discriminatory.
I don't know that it's bad. I just think they were poorly written. Mm-hmm. It's like the laws over there at, in Idaho, no electronics on your bow. Well, that's a broad statement.
Mm-hmm.
Written before they ever invented the GoPro. Mm-hmm. And so you can't put a GoPro on your bow, although the law was only written so you couldn't put something like a laser on there,
yeah,
or something that would help you, you know, have an electronic bow, which would help you mm-hmm. shoot your animal more easily.
GoPro,
it wasn't built there. It wasn't a law established for GoPros. And the GoPro has no impact on your hunt or your shot or the animal or anything. But if you put a electronic device in the form of a GoPro on your bow, you're breaking the law. It should have been written better. Mm-hmm. Should have been written. It was just some idiot didn't think about the future or mm-hmm. or the. So you get a ticket if you have a GoPro mounted to your bow or a tacticam or anything like that, because technically it's the law. Mm-hmm. Even though they know the law, it wasn't written with that intent. So the whole thing, that's how commercial filmmaking laws are. They fall in that bucket.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to get into it in a lot of detail. A lot of people in this, in both within the industry and outside the industry, they don't know what the laws are or how it works. It should mm-hmm. be fixed.
And we talk to people who are the people who enforce these laws.
Yeah.
And they still could not give us a straight answer.
We had different answers depending on who you talk to. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was conversing with Jason Matzinger just last night about this. And what's frustrating about it is it's almost as though you're penalized for hunting on public land. The government has so many fingers in what we're, if you want to film on public land, if I take my iPhone out and I want to put it on YouTube and my name's Brian Call, you're screwed. Mm-hmm. There's like all sorts of rules and things you got to go through. And it's to the point where you're penalized greatly if you want to hunt on public land. It doesn't, like Jason was mentioning, he has to pick a spot. You got to pick a spot. I'm going to be right mm-hmm. here and within this 5 mile radius.
And you can't go out of it.
And he can't go out of it. And if he goes out of it, he has to get new permits mm-hmm. or he has to contact someone. And, by the way, it's like old school phone or email. There's no digital process to log on and say, I'm going to move to this spot or that spot. There's no infrastructure. Everything is done on a PDF form and you email it to someone. And good luck finding
including
out who
billing.
To email. Like the whole thing is from the 90s,
mm-hmm.
late 90s, like just after the internet was invented. So that's another discussion, folks.
Yeah, but, well, we're going to get into
but it is a problem for us because we're trying to get film content out and you guys are asking about it. And I don't know what we're going to be able to release and what we're not going to be able to release.
Mm-hmm. There will be films.
Yeah. But
how many we're going to be able to do, that might be changing. We're not sure yet.
And the thing is if you're on private,
you can film to
your heart's content.
You
can do whatever you want.
Yep.
And you don't get ticketed if you make a mistake, by the way.
Yep.
The whole thing is just frustrating. Anyway, that's another discussion.
Yes.
But thanks for tuning in and stay gritty.